So good morning. I'd like to thank you all to Yale Interventional Radiology Grand Rounds. I'm very honored, excited to introduce to you today's speaker and good friend, Dr. Dimitrios Filippiadis. Dr. Filippiadis graduated from the Second Medical School, Charles University in Prague, Czech Republic, completed his PhD at the Medical School of Athens and his interventional training at the National and Kapodistrian University. He then served as a senior consultant in interventional radiology in the second department of radiology at the University General Hospital in Athens, Greece. And currently, although I found that maybe he will no longer be, but he is an assistant professor of diagnostic and interventional radiology at the medical school at the National and Kapodistrian University, as well as consultant in musculoskeletal imaging and non-vascular IR techniques, as well as being the head of interventional oncology at the Mediterraneo Hospital in Athens, Greece. So what I mean by that is that, as we'll get into, he may soon very well not be an assistant professor anymore. He's not gonna get fired from his job, but it sounds like he's gonna be promoted to associate professor, which I think is long overdue. So as although he is an assistant professor, Dr. Filippiadis is an international figure in interventional radiology. He's been extremely involved in CIRSE, which for those of you that don't know, is the Cardiovascular and Interventional Society of Europe. He served on its membership committee, its standards of practice committee, and many others. And he's also served in multiple other societal capacities, such as being on the European Congress of Radiology Scientific Program Chair for IR. He's currently on the Society of Interventional Oncology Scientific Program Committee, as well as the RSNA Program Planning Committee for IR. And these are just a few examples of his extensive involvement. He also serves on the editorial board of the journal Cardiovascular and Interventional Radiology, CIRSE's flagship journal. He's also authored or co-authored more than 100 scientific publications, 30 book chapters, and served as faculty at over 180 scientific meetings worldwide. And he's also the recipient of numerous additional grants and awards. He does have a very wide range of clinical and research interests. However, in recent years, he's really become one of the champions, one of the world's authorities on palliative care and pain management, especially those as it relates to oncology patients. So today he's going to be speaking to us on pain management strategies and interventional radiology. And I really, again, like to extend a really warm welcome.
Thank you very much, David, for this kind introduction. Many thanks for the invitation. It is really a pleasure. It's an honor and a privilege for me to give this lecture here in Yale, even virtually. Just a word of caution, every time I'm speaking about pain, sometimes I start today and I finish tomorrow. So if I run over time, feel free to stop me. In the next 40 minutes, I will try to speak to you and give different clinical scenarios for pain management strategies. These are my financial disclosures, and these are the learning objectives I will try to cover. We all know that pain is multifactorial, and if we want to classify pain, there are two rough ways. One is to go based on the substrate. We can have benign versus malignant pain, or versus timing, and we can have acute or chronic pain, or even acute crisis of chronic pain. In this era of opioid overdose crisis, it's of utmost importance to be able to offer non-opioid attractive alternatives for pain palliation and functional restoration. And I'm pretty convinced that these alternatives can be interventional radiology techniques. For too many years, I used to say that these techniques are an additional and extra step in the well-known WHO analgesic ladder. But right now, I am convinced that this is not an additional, it's an intermediate step. And our techniques could be provided and could be offered somewhere between converting weak to strong opioids. And they can easily be combined with weak opioids, or even better, with non-opioid analgesics and anti-inflammatory drugs. In an older market research study held in Japan, Europe, and the States, you can see that the patient pool is really large, and the vast majority of these patients are suffering from pain of benign substrate. Ideally, in every hospital, all these patients should be discussed in a multidisciplinary pain meetings. And there is a bunch of different therapies that can be proposed either solely or in any type of combinations. It goes without saying that imaging guidance is of utmost importance. If you are using imaging guidance, that can increase your technical and clinical efficacy, and at the same time, it can decrease your potential complications rate. If we take, for example, epidural infiltrations, it has been shown in the literature that blind attempts are inaccurate in more than one-third of the cases. This is a paper from Athens a few years ago. What we did is we asked the anesthesiologist to do the epidural infiltrations in the angio suite. They were using the loss of resistance technique, and right before they inject any kind of drug they wished, we asked them to inject 1 to 3 cc's of contrast medium. And what we have found is that in 40% of the cases, there was inaccurate placement of the needle. And when we were speaking about defining the target level, they were wrong in 30% of the cases. The most common reason in patients with degenerative spine for this inaccurate placement, I guess that it is the fatty atrophy of the posterior spinal muscles. When the anesthesiologist or a pain specialist tries to go blindly with the loss of resistance technique, once the needle enters the atrophic posterior spine muscle, there is loss of resistance, and there they feel that they are inside the epidural space, but this is a false feeling. Another example, this is an image provided to me by an orthopedic surgeon who tried to do a blind attempt of ozone injection in a facet joint. As we all know, ozone after the first 3 minutes turns to oxygen. So you can see that air is everywhere in the retroperitoneal space and in the posterior muscles, but nowhere close to the facet joint of interest. Let me say a few words about the most standard pain management techniques, starting with nerve blocks. You can inject a mixture of local anesthetic with corticosteroids, either for diagnostic or for therapeutic purposes. Always remember that if you are mixing corticosteroids, this drug acts on cellular level, so it may take up to 3 to 5 days in order to have the exert of the full effect. Apart from any kind of therapeutic impact, you do have a very significant diagnostic impact. If you have a couple of positive blocks, that means a temporary pain palliation prior to neurolysis, this is a very good indicator for a successful outcome. If we are speaking about neurolysis, we have two major subtypes: chemical neurolysis, which involves the injection of agents like ethanol or phenol. The most common neurolytic mixture consists of a 6:3:1 ratio of absolute ethanol, local anesthetic like bupivacaine, for example, and contrast medium. On the other hand, if we are speaking about thermal neurolysis, we imply the application of radiofrequency or cryoablation for damage to the nerve roots. Starting with radio frequency, you have an increased temperature in the uninsulated tip of the electrode, and that causes a permanent damage to the nerve tissue. Factors governing the success of thermal neurolysis with radio frequency include the current, the size of the electrode, the duration of the procedure, and the underlying tissue characteristics. On the other hand, for cryoanalgesia, we are using different types of probes. We can use the probes already known to us for tumor damage. We can use probes specific designed for neurolysis. What we are trying to do is to decrease the temperature below minus 70 degrees. In any case, if the generator gives you the ability to provide prior to neurolysis sensory and motor stimulation, this will increase your safety and efficacy. With sensory testing, you will know that you are really close to the target nerve. With motor stimulation, you will increase your safety because you will know that you are far away from a motor neuron. Staying a little in cryoneurolysis, what we are trying to do is to create a Sutherland 2 lesion in the nerves. That means we have a break on the axonal level without damaging the neural covering. We know from nerve pathophysiology that when the temperature drops to 10 degrees, there is a temporary signaling inactivation, which at minus 5 degrees turns to conduction block lasting for a few hours to a couple of days. And both these events are related to disruption of the sodium-potassium pump. On the other hand, at minus 20 degrees, we have a Sutherland 2 damage related to axonal and myelin degeneration. The new kid on the block in neurolysis is neuromodulation by means of pulsed radiofrequency, and here we are avoiding thermal lesioning as the temperature is not allowed to reach the level of tissue thermocoagulation. If you try to distinguish between these two techniques, thermal neuralysis increases temperature at up to 90 degrees for radiofrequency, or decreases temperature down to minus 100 for cryo. The session of the duration is up to 90 seconds for radiofrequency or 4 to 10 minutes for cryo neuralysis. On the other hand, for neuromodulation, the temperature does not go over 42 degrees and the duration of the session lasts between 4 to 12 minutes. What we are doing in practice with thermal neuralysis is that we are creating a hole in the nerve. On the other hand, with neuromodulation, at least in theory, we are creating a net that blocks signals over and below a specific threshold. From technical point of view, and I think this is the most important stuff, we should approach the nerve on a parallel direction. That will increase our efficacy, and at the same time, it will avoid any kind of complicated neurolytic effects, like, for example, if you go vertically and you puncture the nerve. Imaging is of utmost importance. I strongly believe that computed tomography supersedes any other imaging modality due to its high contrast and spatial resolution, the ability to clearly depict the electrode or the cryo probe, and the relation of the apparatus to any sensitive surrounding structures. Starting with cancer pain, we have two different types, somatic or visceral, which is caused by ongoing tissue damage, and neuropathic, which is related to damage or dysfunction in the nervous system. In this latter case, the resulting pain is more difficult to be treated and frequently fails systemic analgesia. According to international guidelines, different types of pain or pain syndromes can be met in different stages of cancer disease. And the most important issue is that the vast majority of cancer patients, with a proportion up to 80%, are undertreated. Specifically for bone metastatic lesions, radiation is considered in the literature the gold standard. However, if you dig in the literature, you will see that it is governed by moderate success. If we are speaking about complete pain responses, the success rate is up to 24%. And even if we combine overall pain responses, including both complete and partial pain palliation effect, the success rate does not go over 60%. The limitations of ablation include areas that have not reached the dose limit, the cumulative radiation tolerance of nearby organs, the fact that the technique is closely related and dependent on tumor histology, and we have a lot of radio-resistant tumors, the fact that radiation therapy does not improve stability, on the contrary, it weakens the adjacent bone with an effect on pathologic fracture. And now we have data supporting specifically for SBRT, that for a peripheral skeleton, there is a chance of 11% of pathologic fracture that goes up to more than 33% in the spine in the first 4 months after SBRT. I guess for all these reasons, the recent version of the NCCN guidelines for adult cancer pain has included not only ablation, but all kinds of interventional radiology techniques for pain palliation. And this is one of the papers referred in this version of guidelines for all the interventional radiology techniques aiming for pain palliation. Before you start proposing any kind of technique to a patient, there are certain issues that should be considered. There are clinical issues. You should distinguish between local versus diffuse pain, between the presence of mechanical or inflammatory pain. If you want to distinguish between these two types of pain, mechanical pain is the type of pain that it's aggravated during standing situation or during movement. On the other hand, inflammatory pain troubles the patient throughout the day, even when he's lying in bed. Of course, you should take into account the performance status of the patient and a list of technical issues, including recent imaging, if there is a metastatic or primary lesion present, if there is impending pathologic fracture, if there are any close by vessels, and if you have close by sensitive structures. Starting with neurolysis, this technique actually works on the sympathetic nervous system. It's a chain of ganglions running on both sides of the spine from the cervical level till the coccyx. There are different targets that you can apply neurolysis aiming for pain palliation, especially in cancer patients. Starting from stellate ganglion is located right anterior to the first thoracic rib, medially to the vertebral artery. Neurolysis of stellate ganglion is indicated for nociceptive and neuropathic pain, secondary to malignancies affecting the upper limb, the thoracic viscera, head and neck region. You can also propose this kind of neurolysis for iatrogenic plexopathy, post-mastectomy pain or hot flashes in breast cancer patients. And you can see examples of stellate ganglion neurolysis under computed tomography guidance. Once you are there, you can inject a small amount of contrast medium and then apply your chemical or thermal neurolysis. Another example from the left side, once again, under computed tomography. And even if you are having a tumor blocking your entrance route, you can think outside the box, and in well-selected cases, you can apply a transthyroidal approach in order to reach the stellate ganglion. Going downwards to celiac plexus and splanchnic nerves, this is the most common location for neurolysis. Celiac plexus can be imaged as linear densities on both sides of the orifice of celiac axon from the abdominal aorta, whilst splanchnic nerves are located bilaterally anterolateral to T12 vertebral body. This kind of neurolysis can be indicated for persistent and intractable abdominal pain due to gastroesophageal malignancies, metastatic liver cancer, or malignancies related to retroperitoneal lymph node metastasis. Additionally, this kind of neurolysis can be indicated for management of severe nausea and vomiting. The most common applied approach is the transcrural approach. If you are applying chemical neurolysis, you have a 22G spinal needle passing through the diaphragmatic grooves. Once you are at the level of the aorta, you can inject a small amount of contrast medium just to have an idea where the injectate will go. And then you are injecting the mixture of ethanol, local anesthetic, and contrast medium. You can do that unilaterally. You can do that bilaterally. And of course, you can apply either chemical or thermal neurolysis. In most of the cases for thermal neurolysis, radiofrequency ablation is applied. There are different other approaches that you can use. You can go with a transaortic approach if you are using a 22G spinal needle. You can use a retroperitoneal approach. And of course, apart from radiofrequency, you can apply cryoneurolysis at the level of the celiac plexus as well. The results from celiac plexus neurolysis are really impressive. The pain palliation effect can go up to 90%. It's an immediate palliation effect, and it is related with a reduction in opioid medication and opioid-related side effects. The sooner in the disease and the pain course you apply the neurolysis, the better is the outcome. This is a very safe technique. The complication rate is below 2%. And the most common complications include transient post-neurolytic hypotension and diarrhea, and therefore aggressive prior hydration with 0.5 to 1 liter of normal saline is warranted in order to avoid these temporary adverse events. apart from a celiac plexus, you can apply neurolysis at the level of the splanchnic nerves. These are images from bilateral approach with radiofrequency electrodes placement at the level of T12 vertebral body. Initially, we were doing a bilateral approach on T11 and T12 vertebral bodies. We have seen that applying neurolysis on both sides of T12 suffices for a very good palliation effect. My anecdotal experience, and this is the first technical note published with our first five cases, is that the palliation effect is even better if you are using cryoneurolysis. We have applied in five patients bilateral cryoneurolysis at T12 vertebral body in the splanchnic nerves level. All five patients, they had pancreatic cancer and intractable resistant abdominal pain. There was a significant pain palliation effect that lasted for more than 6 months. Going down to superior hypogastric plexus, this plexus is located right in front of L5S1 intervertebral disc. You can use a posterolateral approach. You can use a transdiscal approach, which is even better. This kind of neurolysis is indicated for pain secondary to pelvic cancer involving genitalia, prostate, and rectum. Ganglion impar can be found in front of the coccyx. It can be approached either under computed tomography with a posterolateral approach, or you can use fluoroscopy, a direct posterior approach, and you pass your needle through the intervertebral disc that can be found in the coccyx. Once you are there, you are injecting contrast medium, and after that, you can apply chemical or thermal neurolysis. Obviously, you can use cone beam CT to increase your safety and efficacy. Last but not least, we have pudental nerves. We do a lot of cryoneurolysis on pudental nerves, mainly for female patients with genital cancer. And it's another technique with significant and immediate pain palliation effect. In all the cases that we have done, patient is coming, she's crying from pain, and the moment she stands up from the CT bed, you can see the smile in her face. The pain is already gone. As already said, these kind of procedures are really safe. The complication rate is below 2%. I think apart from hypotension or diarrhea, the most common complication in the abdominal area, or at least in the upper abdominal area, could be pneumothorax in case of thoracic splanchnic nerves, in case of celiac plexus or stellate ganglion approach. You can easily treat pneumothorax the way you do in all other interventional radiology techniques. Moving on from neurolysis to my most favorite pain palliation technique, this is ablation. Nowadays in the market, we have different techniques that they can be applied on tumors causing pain in different patients. If we are speaking about bone metastatic disease, in the literature, radiofrequency and cryoablation, they have tons of data supporting application of these techniques for pain palliation. Microwaves and HIFU are the new kids on the block, and all these techniques are trying to necrotize tumor-periosteum interface to provide tumor decompression, reduction of inflammation, and inhibition of osteoclast activity, aiming for pain palliation with or without functional restoration. The rationale to apply ablation for pain palliation includes the minimal invasive character of the technique, which renders it a well-tolerated event, even in patients with significant comorbidities or with extensive disease. The technique is governed by a very low overall morbidity, which is related to an impressive and reliable pain palliation effect. And if you want to combine ablation with augmentation techniques, the ablation offers lubrification of the tumor, a cavity creation, which allows a better filling with cement injection. In the literature, there are numerous studies utilizing different ablation techniques, all of them reporting significant pain palliation effect. Radiofrequency ablation is the gold standard for osseous metastatic disease. The technique is governed by several disadvantages like tissue charring, the size of the ablation zone, the heat sink effect, and the presence of the intact cortex. And if you have sensitive nerve roots close by to the expected ablation zone, application of radiofrequency might preclude the use of nerve monitoring because of signal interference. This is the most recent publication for radiofrequency ablation. It's the Opus 1 study enrolling 100 patients with a variable neoplasmatic substrate. In the vast majority of the lesions, it was a combined approach with ablation and cementoplasty. And the authors reported significant pain reduction effect throughout the 6 months follow-up. In this specific study, they used a bipolar radiofrequency device initially designed for the spine. It has to be noted that this kind of bipolar devices are gaining more and more application in the peripheral skeleton, especially if you have a sensitive nerve root lying close by to your expected ablation zone. But of course, it goes without saying that you can use the standard radiofrequency electrodes as well. Cryoablation is governed by significant advantages, the most important of which that you have a visible ablation zone because you can see the ice ball, and the ice ball can penetrate all types of osseous cortex. Last but not least, you can provide ice ball sculpting, and by means of multi-probe insertion, you can treat large bulky tumors. The technique is less injurious to articular cartilage, ligaments, and joint, and it can provide an inherent anesthetic effect of tissue cooling. Therefore, in most of the cases, you will not need an anesthesiologist present, and you can apply ablation only under local anesthesia. Of course, disadvantages include the increased duration and the increased cost of the technique. In the most recent publication, the MOTION study, including 65 patients, the authors reported significant pain palliation effect, significant need reduction in the medication need, and significant improvement in the life quality, rendering cryoablation a rapid and durable pain palliation technique. These are different examples of cryoablation, a large soft tissue mass in the thoracic wall causing pain. We have used two cryo probes, and you can see that we have injected contrast medium with normal saline in order to apply hydrodissection and increase the distance between skin and the ice ball. And additionally, we have placed a sterile glove with warm water on the skin. If you want to increase the cost efficacy of the technique, the larger the probe you are using in MSK, the lesser the number of probes that you will need for a sufficient ice ball to cover the lesion. Microwave as a technique overcomes radiofrequency disadvantages and can produce larger ablation zones in a shorter period of time. The technique works equally well in sclerotic metastasis. However, it's not well established in medical literature. In a recent systematic review of the literature, including 7 non-comparative trials with more than 300 tumors, including both benign and malignant lesions, the authors report that microwave is a safe and efficacious technique. However, it is governed by a wide variety on the proposed protocols, and the technique really needs standardization for MSK and for bone ablation. Different examples of microwave, once again, a large soft tissue mass in the thoracic wall treated with microwave ablation. This time the glove obviously contains chilled water rather than warm. And another example of renal cell carcinoma in the scapula treated with microwave ablation. HIFU is a totally non-invasive technique for pain palliation. Up until now, we have a single phase 3 clinical trial randomizing patients in an MR-guided HIFU and a sham control group. And the authors reported a significantly better palliation effect in the MR-guided HIFU arm. In a more recent meta-analysis, including more than 100 metastatic lesions, authors concluded that at present, HIFU cannot be systematically performed as a non-invasive alternative for pain palliation of bone lesions. However, if you combine HIFU with augmentation and ancillary techniques like hydrodissection, you could increase the number of eligible cases. And this is a metastatic lesion from thyroid cancer in the scapula, initially treated with radiofrequency ablation. There is disease recurrence in 2016. treated with MR-guided HIFU, and this is the result with the necrotic zone after the ablation session. At the moment, we do not have randomized comparative trials suggesting superiority of one ablation technique over the other. In a retrospective propensity score analysis, including 50 patients who underwent either radiofrequency or cryoablations, authors concluded that cryoablation significantly improved not only the palliation effect of not only improved pain, but also provided a reduction in the requirement of narcotic medications. However, both techniques resulted in life quality improvement. In a similar retrospective propensity score matching analysis, once again between radiofrequency and cryo, focusing this time on safety, it has been shown that both techniques are governed by a similar major complication rate that goes up to 2.4%. However, there was a higher minor complication rate, mostly related with radiofrequency ablation in terms of immediate post-procedural pain. In two papers published in Radiology Journal focusing on complications after bone ablation, one for radiofrequency and the other for cryoablation, it has been shown that for both techniques, the major complication rate is around 2%. However, once again, it is pointed out that for radiofrequency ablation, there is a significantly higher immediate postoperative pain percent. Obviously, the force has a dark side, and you should consent your patients for complications, including neural injury. You should always remember that the threshold for injury is up to 42 degrees when you are using high temperature ablation techniques, down to 6 to 10 degrees when you are using cryoablation. Additionally, you should consent your patients for complications related to applicator placement or damage, pathologic fracture, inadvertent osteochondral injury. And if you want to treat large-sized tumors, you should always remember that the necrotic debris entering the systemic circulation after ablation might cause myoglobinuria. Therefore, once again, aggressive hydration is warranted in the immediate post-ablation effect. Period. Obviously, there are different passive and active thermoprotective techniques, including application of thermocouples, intraoperative neurological monitoring, hydro or gas dissection, and skin warming or cooling. The major advantage of ablation is that it can be easily combined with surgery, with radiation therapy, with all others, with all other interventional radiology techniques. And leaving radiation therapy aside, the greatest thing about ablation is that you can offer a single session combined approach in the vast majority of the patients. As far as radiation therapy is concerned, from 2011, we have papers suggesting that combining ablation with radiotherapy seems to result and provide a significantly better pain palliation effect. However, we should admit that even today, we do not know which is the ideal timing to combine one technique with the other and which technique should precede the other. In the CIRSE guidelines published in 2010 for tumor ablation, it has been written that you can easily combine bone ablation with augmentation techniques, and there are different factors governing such a decision, including the presence of pain, and especially of mechanical pain, the location and the size of the lesion, any related distraction of the bone cortex, the presence of pathologic fracture, and of course, previous local therapies, including radiation therapy. You can easily apply triple combinations, including ablation of the lesion, transarterial embolization, and then augmentation by means of cannulated screws and cement injection. In a recent meta-analysis, including a vast number of studies, in most of these studies, it has been proposed that ablation should be combined with augmentation techniques in order to provide a significantly better pain palliation effect. And augmentation techniques involve either cement injection as a standalone treatment or combination of cement, either with cannulated screws or with big polymer implants. Up until now, we do not have a therapeutic guideline in order to know when to provide a combination approach using ablation and cementation or any other augmentation techniques. In my own personal practice, I always, in the vast majority of the cases, I wish to combine ablation with cementation and any kind of augmentation. First, in order to improve stability, and most importantly, in order to avoid tumoral dissemination along the screw trajectory. And this is one of the first case reports reporting tumor dissemination after placement of cannulated screws back in 2018. You should always consider the access to the lesion, the extent of the ablation zone, the protection of the surrounding structures, and your ability to provide combination treatments. However, you should always remember that ablation is a feasible, safe, and efficacious technique, and it is already included in the NCCN guidelines for adult cancer pain. We have different techniques available, so ideally, we want to provide a patient and lesion-tailored approach in order to maximize our efficacy. Speaking about benign pain now, the most common pathology related to benign pain seems to be vertebral fractures. And vertebral fractures are really very common and they cost a lot. The cost for treatment of vertebral fracture, if you leave aside percutaneous techniques, seems to be higher than the money spent for breast cancer or for myocardial infarction and stroke. With percutaneous vertebral techniques, we can provide therapy, we can provide stabilization and pain palliation in all kinds of stable vertebral fractures. Apart from pain reduction for improvement in mobility, we are improving the kyphotic angle as well, and this is related to an improvement in the pulmonary function, in the appetite, in the nutritional impact, and any frailty of the patient related to the vertebral fracture. At the moment, we have different techniques, including vertebroplasty, balloon augmentation, spine implants. And the reason why we need to have these different techniques is because we have a wide variety of different vertebral fractures, and not all these are treated with the same way. It's a different animal to deal with if you are having an osteoporotic fracture compared to a cancer-related fracture or to a presence of hemangioma or a lesion related to multiple myeloma or lymphomas. The common thing should be the presence of the fracture and the presence of bone edema in a steer sequence in MRI imaging. Percutaneous vertebroplasty is technique related to standard injection of cement inside the vertebral body, and it can be easily applied not only to a single level, but you can also provide therapy for multiple fractured vertebral bodies in the same session without endangering safety or efficacy of the technique. As it has been shown in the CIRSE guidelines, there is significant pain palliation effect and success rate related to vertebroplasty and balloon augmentation, going up to 90% for osteoporotic fracture or even 85% for malignant cases. The threshold for clinically significant adverse events and complications should be below 2% for benign substrate and below 10% for malignant cases. Alternative to vertebroplasty is balloon augmentation. You are creating a cavity, you are inflating a balloon, and this is followed by cement injection. And once again, you can propose this technique either for single or for multiple level treatment. The indications are more or less the same. The complication and success rate is the same. And up until now in the literature, we do not have data to support that one technique is superior to the other. Implants is a paradigm shift away from the standard PMMA injection. We do have in our availability jacks, stents, and PICC cases, and these implants are designed to achieve durable fracture reduction, aiming not only towards height restoration, but most importantly for end plate alignment and kyphotic angle restoration. In the market, we have numerous devices, but we don't have the evidence suggesting that one device is superior to the other. However, we do have evidence that all these devices are non-inferior when compared to balloon augmentation or vertebroblasty. The most commonly applied questions is, can we challenge surgery with percutaneous techniques? And the answer is clearly yes. If you see, we have a similar success rate, we have lower complication rate, and percutaneous techniques are more cost-effective than surgical approaches. And I guess this is the reason why, even now, if you dig in the literature, you will see that orthopedic surgeons and neurosurgeons, when they speak about surgical approach, they mean application of balloon augmentation in most of the cases. If you compare augmentation techniques with medical therapy, you can see that the outcome concerning pain palliation, life quality improvement, and mobility improvement is much better in the patients treated with augmentation techniques. And if you have malignant lesions in the spine, we have a lot to do if we want to compare ablation with radiation therapy. We do have new devices. We can apply bilateral approach, but specifically for posterior lesions, I think there is a lot of work to be done in order to be able to match radiation oncologists in this level. Closing up, and I won't take much of your so much more of your time, a few words about benign pathologies. Low back pain is way too common a symptom in the population. 80% of normal population will experience at least one episode of low back pain during their lifetime. Up to 45%, they will complain at least once in a year for low back pain. 40% of these complaints are related to intervertebral disc herniation, and another 40% is related to degeneration of facet joints or sacroiliac joints. You can propose conservative therapy, you can propose endoscopic or surgical therapies, and somewhere in between you can provide nerve block injections or percutaneous approaches. In all cases, remember, you should apply strict sterility measures. This is a benign substrate. If you end up with a patient with spondylodiscitis, this is a very bad scenario. The patient will be in need for antibiotics for at least 3 to 6 months, and this is the good scenario, not including the need for surgical operations. For intervertebral disc herniation, you can propose nerve block infiltrations, either epidural or foraminal, and of course, you can use any kind of imaging available. The same goes for the cervical spine. The only difference is that in the lumbar or thoracic level, we can easily combine corticosteroids with local anesthetics. In the cervical spine, we avoid to use anesthetic, therefore we are mixing corticosteroid with normal saline. The vast majority of these patients with clearly improve without any need for percutaneous or surgical approaches. And this is a case of a patient with herniation in 2011, 1 year after, only with a single nerve injection for pain palliation. There was a complete disappearance of the hernia. Discogenic pain is associated with a complex pathophysiology, including the presence of nerve fibers, the mechanical pressure in the nerve root, inflammation, and neovascularization. We have in our arsenal different techniques, either decompression techniques or implantation of biomaterials for disc regeneration. All decompression techniques are related to the fact that disc is a closed hydraulic space, and in these closed spaces, any kind of small volume changes are related to great pressure changes. Indications for proposing percutaneous treatment of hernia include the presence of a small to medium-sized herniation in symptomatic patients, and the symptoms should be consistent with the segmental level where the herniation is seen in MR imaging. Sphincter dysfunction, extreme sciatica, and progressed neurologic deficits are absolute indications for surgery, and an absolute contraindication is the presence of sequestration, infection, or asymptomatic herniation. You can easily apply percutaneous decompression technique under fluoroscopy in the Scotty dog projection, direct posterior medial access to the disc. Once you are there, you have your access and you can insert any kind of material you feel more comfortable to use, ranging from decompressors to ozone injection or any kind of other materials available in one's country. Complications are way too rare, below 0.5%. The most fearsome is infection going up to 0.25% per patient. The results, if we want to compare percutaneous approaches with surgery, are more or less the same. The success rate for surgery is at 95%. The success rate for percutaneous techniques is at 80-85%. However, the complication rate after surgery can go up to 5%. Different studies in the literature utilizing application of percutaneous approaches showing non-inferiority of these techniques to surgical approaches. It goes without saying, and it has been proven, that this kind of techniques do better than conservative therapy in the long term. This is a randomized prospective trial. In the first 3 months after treatment, all patients, they were doing really well, but at 12 months and 2 years follow-up period, patients who underwent percutaneous approach did significantly better than the ones treated with conservative therapy. Closing up with osteoarthritis in the spine, you can see osteoarthritis in the facet joints in terms of facet joint syndrome, synovial cysts or spondylolysis. You can easily treat this kind of patients with the standard injection inside the facet joint. And if you have a positive test and the pain comes back after a couple of weeks, you can carry on with neurolysis. Remember that these facet joints, they have a dual innervation. Therefore, you should provide neurolysis on at least two subsequent levels. This is your target point, the junction of the transverse to the superior articulating surface. This is the point where the posterior branches of the median nerves are crossing. Always remember, apply neurolysis in two subsequent levels. You can do that under fluoroscopy, under CT guidance, or if you want, you can use the angio suite, cone beam CT, in order to increase your safety and efficacy. MR-guided HIFU is totally non-invasive. However, it costs the costs related to the technique are higher, the duration is higher. Similar, you can apply infiltrations or neurolysis for sacroiliac joint. Here you have four different levels, either right next to the joint or right next to the four sacral foramina where the nerves exit the foramen. Last but not least, in knee osteoarthritis, you can provide different interventional radiology techniques, including intra-articular injections using corticosteroids, hyaluronic acid, PRPs. You can provide neurolysis. And once again, we are speaking either for thermal neurolysis at the level of genicular nerves or for neuromodulation. Genicular nerves, you are targeting the superior lateral, superior and lower medial. These three target points, first of all, you are applying local anesthesia, followed by insertion of the radiofrequency electrodes and continuous radiofrequency ablation, two sessions of 85 to 90 degrees, each session lasting for 90 seconds. Very good results if you compare these techniques with some therapies. Intra-articular application of pulsed radiofrequency, temperature below 42 degrees, ideal technique. It takes 10 seconds to place the needle, and this is the final point in midline of the joint. After that, you just wait for 10-12 minutes for the neuromodulation session. Once again, very good results for a 6 to 12 months follow-up. Results seem to be better if you compare neuromodulation with intra-articular application of hyaluronic acid. And of course, you can do the same thing in all kinds of peripheral joints, going from shoulder, elbow, hip, and any kind of joints. Do not forget a lot of MSK symptoms of benign substrate, including Alcock syndrome for pudental nerves, piriformis syndrome, greater occipital neuralgia, or trigeminal neuralgia. All these patients, they can be treated with initial nerve block followed by neurolysis, most importantly, before they reach the level of need of strong opioids. Closing up, interventional radiology techniques may act either indirectly or directly to provide significant pain palliation and life quality improvement. They are governed by low morbidity. They have a minimal invasive nature. They are in need for short hospitalization. And in cancer patients, they don't need to interrupt systemic chemotherapy. You need to optimize your selection by providing a patient-tailored approach. And I think I will never be tired of saying that in the era of opioid overdose crisis, if you are able to offer this kind of non-opioid alternatives, it's a good way to build relations with referring doctors, hospital administrators, and local media by proposing these attractive alternatives for pain management. This is the reason why pain management is included for the accreditation, at least in Europe, of any interventional oncology department. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm here to answer all kinds of questions and comments raised.
Thanks, Dimitrios. That was awesome. Totally great overview of pain management. I have a number of questions. I'm sure that the audience does too. If people can actually answer or ask in the question and answer box, that would be great. One of the things that I want to know is the very last point of your take home was about getting in touch with your referrers and your administrators and all that to increase the usefulness or workflow for these kinds of approaches. So, you know, Yale is probably one of the largest healthcare systems in the United States. And it just seems to me that at least in interventional radiology, we're not doing as many of these procedures as we, in my opinion, should be. So how do you actually do that? Like, how do you build up that referral base? Does it take a very long period of time? Do you have to go to all these, you have to give grand rounds at all these different like sites? Like what do you actually do to get that going?
Thank you, David. That is a real great question. Honestly speaking, it doesn't take so much time if you know where to start. My first target group was oncologists. All these doctors, they are dealing with patients in pain. And what they do, they are giving analgesics, they are giving opioids to them. So I went, I spoke to all the oncologists in my hospital, and I said that you can try neurolytic techniques, you can try nerve injections, and you will see that the pain will go away. This will increase your efficacy because the patient will come easier to you for chemotherapy. And I don't have to do anything by putting obstacles to your systemic therapy administration. Once I make them believe that this can happen and we had the first positive pain palliation effect in the first cases, everything was really easy. And the best thing that we did after the first year is that we start having multidisciplinary pain meetings once per week. In these meetings, we have a pain specialist, which at least in my country, they think that this is the anesthesiologist. So we have anesthesiologists, we have neurosurgeons, we have orthopedic surgeons, and we have oncologists. And all these specialties, they are bringing different cases for discussion. Oncologists, they will always be happy to refer patients to you in order to take the pain away from the patient. And yes, sometimes These pain meetings, they look like a saloon bar in the Far West when I'm fighting with neurosurgeons and orthopedic surgeon about a vertebral augmentation techniques. But in most of the cases, everybody is happy to refer the patient to you for a pain palliation effect. Even the radiation therapists, they seem to believe that combining ablation with radiation makes them look better. So they are referring the patients to us for ablation after radiation therapy.
Yeah, so we have one question, I guess, which just led from your answer. And then I have another, I guess, corollary, which is how do you work with orthopedic surgeons? And then I would add anesthesiologists, because anesthesiologists are the ones also that are doing a lot of these, at least these blocks, without them feeling like you're taking their patients from them or taking over their procedures, which I guess you kind of alluded to, but like when you said it's the Wild West, and I know you've been to the Wild West a couple of times at least. how do you deal with that interaction?
First of all, let me tell you that different interactions are related to different specialties. For example, the answer for anesthesiologists is imaging. At least in my country, what they have available is either ultrasound or fluoroscopy for imaging. And I think you must be really brave to try and do a celiac plexus neurolysis with fluoroscopy or with imaging. I know that it can be done, but using computed tomography makes your life much easier, increases the safety and the efficacy of your technique. So I'm better on them because I'm using computed tomography and other specialties for this kind of neurolytic techniques. They prefer to send them to the IR department rather to the anesthesiologist. Obviously, I'm always being polite and I say to them that systemic therapy is all yours. You are the one, the person running the orchestra. You are giving the systemic therapies. I'm just the first violin trying to play my own music. With orthopedic surgeons, it's a tough battle. I mean, they are doing their own cases. We are doing our own cases. But even with a proportion, let's say 30% of them, they prefer to send patients to interventional radiology department because they want to take advantage of operating time in the theater for really high level operations. They prefer to do resection of pelvis rather than to spend operating time for a vertebral augmentation technique.
So, you know, you mentioned, I guess, percutaneous, or I guess using local administration of drugs or neuromodulation for geniculate artery. But as you know, there's a lot of interest now in geniculate artery embolization and others. What's your thoughts on that? Because I guess you didn't really speak to that. Yeah. So do you believe in that? Do you think that that's worth pursuing, or do you think it's much easier just to stick a needle in it and get it done that way?
Well, first of all, let me say that I do believe in both techniques. However, I really find it hard to convince the patient that he will choose embolization over radiofrequency ablation of the genicular nerves. The ablation is way easier. The patient comes in the morning, leaves 1 hour after. Even from logistics approach, it's better. I do agree that the genicular artery embolization is coming, and it's coming really hard on us. But what we don't know, and that stands for ablation as well, is which is the exact location of these techniques in our therapeutic armamentarium. And that is related not only to the timing between these two techniques, but also to the timing with surgery. Can we offer either technique as an alternative to surgery? should we offer ablation before surgery and embolization in failed cases, in failed surgical cases? Can both act as great alternatives versus surgery? I think that these are questions that need to be answered. And we had a great research panel in SIR, including rheumatologists, orthopedic surgeons, pain specialists, and interventional radiologists, concluding that there is a clear need for building registries, comparative trials, in order to be able to answer this kind of questions.
Got it. That's awesome. So I guess we're at the end of the hour. I want to be cognizant of you also. For those of that were not on the call in the very beginning, it sounds like COVID is getting really, really up in numbers in Greece, and that instead of doing these cool procedures, you'll be in the hospital for the next 2 days straight doing GI bleeds on COVID patients. So, with that, I think I don't see any other questions. So I think with that, we'll conclude. I really want to thank you again. Hopefully we'll be able to see each other in the near future. We always have a great time. And with that, I think we'll conclude. So thanks so much again.
Thank you very much for the invitation. It was a pleasure and an honor.
Thanks.
Thank you.